Good morning. It's the 13th day of January in the Lord's year 2011. I'm J. Michael McCoy, and this is Maxworld. Today, Dr. Ron Gruters, part three. You've met him. We've talked about the fact that he's a famous heart surgeon from here in our community. And about 6-7 months ago, he got cancer and how it's changed his life. And as a scientist, he turned to faith as well as science. Science versus faith. Is it hand in hand or is it one against the other? We'll talk about that today, live in Maxworld.
The views expressed by J. Michael McCoy and Maxworld Live are the views of the hosts and guests, and not necessarily those of Webcast One Live, its staff, its management, the cleaning crew, the electric guy, the guy who cuts the grass, the woman who brings us cookies, the wait staff at Winston's, the management staff at Hubble Realty, the guy who fixes our van, the coffee crew at Friedrich's, the man on the skywalk who will work for food, or anyone else of sound mind. Should you be offended, provoked, intimidated, confused, or just made to think independently, call 515-244-4655 or log on to webcastonelive.com and be a part of maxworldlive.com. You can reach Mac right now by calling 515-244-4655. 515-244-4655. You are listening to Maxworld Live with your host, J. Michael McCoy.
Running. Come on, y'all. Let's get it.
Good morning. It's the 13th day of January in the Lord's year 2011. I'm J. Michael McCoy, and this is Maxworld. You know, before we get to my special guest today, I want to show you a cartoon that I see. And I'm a terrible artist. I mean, I can't even draw stick people that look like stick people. So I'm always fascinated with cartoonists, and I enjoy cartoons, whether it be Charlie Brown and Peanuts or whether it be something done from a political sense. It's one of the kind of websites that I like to scour. And I want to show you a cartoon, if I can, that was published yesterday in, it was published in Investors Business Daily. And it's also in the Des Moines Register today, and it is from Michael Ramirez. And I just want you to look at this for a second. And in case you can't read it very well, let me help you. In the middle, of course, is this crazy gunman who killed these people in Tucson, Arizona. That's his mugshot, or a cartoonist version of his mugshot. And here's what it says all the way around it, starting from left and going to right. This is not Sarah Palin. This is not the Tea Party. This is not a divided America. This is not a reason to limit free speech. It is not an indictment of Representative Gifford's record. It is not a reason to take away constitutional rights. This is not Rush Limbaugh. Close. This is not the result of today's political discourse. This is not a dim-witted sheriff politicizing a tragedy. This is a lone, deranged, drug-using murderer. I put it on my Facebook, and I just wanted to share it with you because I think that is, I just think that sums it up. If you want to use it, go to my Facebook and grab the caption and put it anywhere you want. And to Michael Ramirez from Investors Daily Business, I appreciate you having that on there today. I think that's perfect. All right. Welcome to Maxworld on this 13th day of January. It's about 5 after 10 Central Daylight Time. If you're watching this live, it is cold. It is 2 degrees. I held up three fingers. It is 2 degrees outside currently, and as temperatures begin to warm up, we're going to see a little bit of snow later on. But just remember, for those of you that want to complain and whine and grumble about this weather, I want you to remember a year ago in which we had feet and feet of snow on a constant basis, and it was bitterly cold. And by today, we were already tired of winter, and winter stuck around till almost mid-March, early April last year. Also, I spoke to my brother-in-law, Tim, who lives in Avon, Connecticut, and they got 25 inches of snow yesterday. 25 inches of snow. 25 inches doesn't sound very much. It's only about this big. But when you make it cold and fluffy and snow, it is terrible. And I think you've probably also heard this statistic. Out of the 50 states in the nation, 49 of them have snow right now. Even Hawaii has almost 7 inches of snow in the mountains. Only Florida at this time is not reporting snow. And God, if you could just kind of put snow on there so for the first time in American history, we could have 50 states covered with the beautiful snow. So I appreciate that. If you are watching this on a podcast or listening to this off of an iTunes podcast, I really thank you for taking the time to downloading this program. I know you have lots of choices. In today's world, the media is all around us. In fact, you are kind of a part of the media. You know, in the age of the internet, it isn't just those of us who were trained journalists and got degrees and got jobs as news directors or journalists. With the invention of the internet, thank you, Al Gore, and also the term blog, which is nothing more than a written opinion, this, in a way, is a video blog. What I do every day could be coined as a radio show or a television show. It's really an audio-video blog, and you have the same capabilities. So remember, it is your voice that I want to hear in Max World and on WebcastOneLive.com. We always welcome your opinions. This is not a one-sided, biased program. It is always everybody's opinion that makes up this program on a daily basis, and we appreciate you taking the time to download it, to tune in and listen. Also, excuse me. If you can, we've got a live chat going on right in front of us, and you're always welcome to jump in there and log on. You can use whatever name you want. I always appreciate when you use a name that is referenced to you, although I don't always get that. I appreciate you logging in and giving us an idea of your opinion. All right. Let's go to my special guest. You've met him before. He's Dr. Ron Gruters. He is a heart surgeon with Iowa Methodist. And you're a humble guy, but just to refresh, you're not only an excellent heart surgeon, but you also created, invented, developed different medical procedures as well as instruments that help with heart surgery.
That's correct, yeah.
And can you tell us what those were?
Well, the basic one is where you attach the heart-lung machine to the patient, to the aorta, so you can perfuse the body. And that one was...
Hold on, I don't know what perfuse means.
Inject blood back into the body.
So okay.
You take it out and put it back in to keep the pressure up while you work on the heart.
And this, if I can remember the conversations we've had before, this is kind of like they say that necessity is the mother of invention.
Yes.
Kind of how you came up with this.
That's correct. We were having a high incidence back in the early 80s of stroke. And when you looked at the cannula, and it's like a tube, it was like a nozzle on a garden hose.
Okay.
With all the velocity of the blood coming out, it was hitting against the wall of the aorta and washing things off the aorta, and that's how we'd have strokes. So this was a different device where the blood was coming out a lot softer and a lot gentler and a lot more dispersed.
And how often or where is this item used, this device used?
Well, on almost every heart surgery.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, well, that's cool. I don't know if I ever told you this, but when I grew up in Beatrice, Nebraska, I lived at 718 Grant Street, and this would have been prior to 1970. The gentleman that lived across the street and two houses up was the first person to ever receive a heart transplant. And so I got to know this man. We'd sit out in front. I was his paper boy. And back then, of course, that was incredible that you could do a heart transplant. And now, if I understand it, those are done almost every day.
There's probably 5,000 to 8,000 of them done worldwide every year. What limit is the availability of a heart.
Yeah, become a donor, please. It's on my driver's license. It's in my records. For heaven's sakes, be a donor. Why would – well, everybody has their own reason. I won't find criticism. But I can't imagine someone not being a donor.
I can't either.
You know, why not?
Yeah.
All right. But that's not what brings you here. What brings you here is a turn of events in your life 6 or 7 months ago that I'm sure you never expected.
This was right out of the blue, so to speak. And it was very surreal, very quick, and it makes you kind of ill. Just one thinking about it, but the treatment kind of makes you kind of ill for a while also. Yeah. Kind of cut short my my specialty and doing my specialty, although I was thinking of retiring in a year or so.
And what that was you got a brain tumor.
That's correct.
And it was a malignant tumor.
And it's a certain degree of malignancy, yes.
Yeah. And you have had it, you have not, have you had it operated on?
I've had it taken out and then treated with radiation and chemo, and I'm still getting chemo periodically.
And by having it removed, it was biopsied.
Well, you know, they just went in and took it out.
How big was it?
About the size of a cue ball.
That's just incredible.
Yeah. It showed that we don't use our whole brain.
Yeah, right. Yeah,
we
used 90% or 10% of it, or whatever they say. And prior to you discovering that you had this tumor, you were a. Would you have considered yourself a man of faith? If I had asked you a year ago, are you a man of faith? How would you have reacted to that?
Unfortunately, back then, I would have said more of a lukewarm faith.
But you didn't see yourself that way.
I did not see myself.
How did you see yourself?
I saw myself as somebody that was a Christian and believed in Jesus Christ, and I knew I had him in my heart, but I wasn't radical, or I wasn't that every day.
Yeah. Pastor Mike so often refers to it as Christianity or churchianity. No, that's not what he says. Is that what he says? Okay. Christianity or churchianity. So many of us at times in our life are churchianities, really not Christians. And that may have been one way would that be one way to paraphrase what you were?
Yeah, I guess so.
Because you went to church.
You know, I went to church. Didn't go to church all the time, primarily because of my profession. Because on weekends, every third one or so, I was tied up.
Yeah, and you had rounds and patients to take care of.
So I had other things on my mind other than, you know, being a Christian.
You had other things on your mind. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
Wow. That's kind of a profound statement. I had other things on my mind than being a Christian.
Yeah.
And, you know, they say there are no atheists in foxholes. And it is no accident by any means that sometimes I always say God uses disasters or tragedies in our life to bring him closer to us. But I don't say that anymore. It's really us who stray away from God. And through disasters and tragedies, we find ourselves getting closer to him. And so obviously through your tragedy, through your, maybe you don't call it a tragedy.
It's an event. It can't be called a tragedy because a tragedy really involves multiple people or multiple, the way I look at it anyway. It's a bad event. I mean, you don't wish it on anyone.
Right.
But it's an eye-opener as far as, oh, you know what? I have a gift. And it was life. And here's what I've been doing to it. You know, I've been neglecting. I've been working on my profession, but I've been neglecting God. I could have done more for him. That's how it kind of opens your eyes, I think, when you get sick like this.
Was there a period of time when you first found out you were ill that you were angry with God?
No, I never was angry. Matter of fact, I was more looking at myself saying, you know what, I probably almost deserve this.
Really?
And now I'm going to, and eventually I go, now I'm going to do things with my life for God, my Savior, if I can.
You deserve the illness?
That's how I don't know if I deserved it, but that's how I kind of felt.
Okay.
Probably some of my guilt complex coming out a little bit. I mean, it wasn't overpowering, but it was still there in the background.
It made you stop and
think.
Take an inventory of your life.
That's right.
And when you took that inventory, what areas did you find were lacking?
Walking with God, so to speak,
okay.
Taking time to thank Him more often, and also being involved as a witness for Jesus Christ and for God. Now, you know, I want to go full blast as much as I can, much as my health will allow, and be much more involved with my Christian faith than I was back when I was real busy as a heart surgeon.
Okay, so can I be a little cynical for a moment?
You may be as cynical as you want.
It's easy to say. You're in the foxhole. No atheists in foxholes. You're still getting treatment. 6 weeks, 10 weeks, 12 months, whatever it is down the line, you're free and clear and everything's fine. You going to go back? Going to go back to that, I'll go to church if I can, and not really walking with God, but I believe in Jesus Christ, and, you know, I'm a Christian.
That's what I'll have to guard against, because that's the way humans are. That's the way we are. We quite often forget to put back into our faith every day or every week to maintain our faith. Just like a businessman, if he doesn't put back into his business, the business goes away. And I think our faith is the same way. And it helps us then build our faith, or like building a business and making it better.
That's interesting that you would use that analogy. I like that. Building a business and building your faith. There really are concrete, hands-on things that you have to do. And if you don't, your business won't be built on a firm foundation.
That's right. Yeah, it works that way.
All right, we're going to take a break, and when we come back, I love scientists because they have a knowledge of this world and our human bodies and things that go on around us far greater than I can ever conceive. And being a person who's very information hungry, I love learning. But also as a Christian and a man who has a pretty decent walk with his Father God, I always like to hear how people look at science and faith. Is it a versus in the middle, or is it combined together to make a whole? We'll talk to Dr. Ron Gruters about that when we come back. It's about 17 minutes after the hour. If I haven't told you lately, thanks for listening. I love this job. Couldn't do it without you. I'm living the dream right here at MaxWorldLive.com.
Get away from us, you mean old credit card. We don't have any more money.
We're in trouble now.
Save us.
Help. Somebody save us.
Somebody help.
Help.
Save us.
Hi, I'm Tom Coates from Consumer Credit of Des Moines. If your credit card's a little too animated, give us a call.
Hooray, we're saved! Consumer Credit, you're our hero!
The Kincaids live here. Across the street, the Padillas. Ben and his family live here, too. Ben's a RE/MAX agent, and he's a big part of this community. There are lots of reasons why RE/MAX agents average more sales than other agents. Experience, certainly. But maybe it's also because they care about the markets they serve and the neighbors who rely on them. Nobody sells more real estate than RE/MAX.
From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios. Listen, watch, chat. This is Webcast One Live.
Programs on WebcastOneLive.com are brought to you in part by KDC Builders, building custom homes for how you live. KDC will take your dreams and turn them into reality. Go to our website, KDCBuilt.com. Or call Hannah Inman at 515-975-9990. And Tom Coates and ConsumerCreditOfAmerica.com. Are you overwhelmed with mounted credit card debt and feel there's no way out? Well, there is. Call 1-800-955-5765 for Consumer Credit of America. That's CCofAmerica.com. All right, welcome back. 20 minutes after the hour, if you're live, it's Central Daylight Time at 10:20. It is a blistering 3 degrees in central Iowa. But again, I feel pretty lucky. I talked to my brother-in-law this morning who lives in Avon, Connecticut, and they had 25 inches of snow in the last 24 hours. And it is pretty blasted out there, and they've got another cold front coming through, as we do, by the way. But hey, it's January. It's Iowa. Nothing that gets under my skin more than somebody who complains about the weather who chooses to live in Iowa. But anyway, well, you know what? I shouldn't say that because I'm a whiner too. When it's August and 100 degrees, I am a big complainer of the weather. So I guess I should look at myself in the mirror and realize that I complain too. I just happen to love this cold weather. My wife got home from work yesterday and went to the thermostat, and I'd set it on 61 because I just like it cold. And but I have improved, Dr. Gruters. I no longer open the sliding glass door when I'm watching television. I did that from time to time. Anyway, for those of you that are just joining us for the first time on this broadcast, thank you very much. If you're listening to this off of iTunes or on an audio only, we appreciate that. We try not to do too many visuals so it throws you off. For those of you that are watching and haven't seen before, you'll notice we have our new green screen technology up. And this is from high above a penthouse in New York City. And we can put anything we want on there. Tomorrow, when we do View from the Pew, we're going to have some different church backgrounds in the background. We can do just about anything. And I sure appreciate Max, our producer, who makes sure this all works for us. And it's just amazing what's happening here at WebcastOneLive.com. When we started this project 2 years ago, I had no idea. I could not have envisioned this by any means. And my partner, Rob Spearman, is just such an awesome guy. And he's really got his arms around this technology. And he and Max and Esme and Chris DeBolt and some of the people that are involved in the technical end of this project have developed the green screen technology. And it's just pretty cool. And we play with it from time to time. We can put almost anything we want in the background. You know, we ought to get a shot, Max, of maybe a big snowstorm coming down that we could put in back of us to kind of give us that feeling. And then maybe the next shot could be a sunny beach somewhere in Florida or Hawaii. Although they do have, remember, they have snow in Hawaii. Did you realize that? 49 states right now in our continental United States. 49 states have snow. And that the only one out, of course, is Florida. They do not have any snow on the ground, but keep wishing. It'll be there pretty soon. So anyway, we have lots of different technologies that we can use behind us. This, as I said, is a penthouse high above the city of New York. And 49 out of 58. Where do you get 50? I think you pushed the wrong button. You meant 49 out of 50. Yes, okay. Other guy says, I'm still voting for the dancing girls. We're not going to have dancing girls as a background. Anyway, we'll play with that in just a little bit and try to give you some different images. It's really amazing. We just go to Google and put what we want in there, pictures of churches, snowstorms, whatever it is, and then click images and then save that picture as whatever we want to call it and bring it up. I was also told that with the today's smartphones, that any picture I might take on my smartphone would also look just as good as the picture we have here in the background. So as we progress on this platform, we'll have more and more fun. And for those of you that don't think you've ever seen a green screen technology, watch Channel 13 Weather with Ed Wilson. Everything they do in that weather center is on green screen. I think they have one item that is permanent behind him, but everything else is green screen. There we go. Look at that picture. Boy, that looks like my street. Dr. Ron, if you want to turn that computer around, you can see it there. That looks like Country Club Clive Woodlands right out there. It's not, but oh my gosh, look at that weather. So now I'm getting cold just sitting here. And anyway, that's what we can do. So feel free just to throw anything you want in there, Max, and have some fun with us today. And good morning to my beautiful daughter, Trina, who is, what are you now, Trina, 33 weeks pregnant? I know you feel like you're 133 weeks, but 33 weeks pregnant. And
it won't be long.
Yeah, here in a few weeks, going to bring a grandson into the world, and named Gibson. They named him already. You know, with today's technology. In fact, the other day we went to the 3D ultrasound. Boy, was that cool, which I'm sure you've seen.
Oh, yeah.
But that was good. 33 and a half. I'm surprised, Trina, you don't have like 33 in days and hours. There we go. Look at that background. Now, that's the background we want in Iowa.
There you go.
There we go. That's a beautiful background. All right. Dr. Ron Gruters is my guest today, and he is a very loved and blessed heart surgeon here in Central Iowa, was with Methodist for many years, still with Methodist. My guess is you know somebody who knows somebody who Dr. Ron Gruters had an impact on their life through his medicine, either by his own hands or by some medical devices and ideas that he's come up with and patented, which has made a great impact on anybody ever having any kind of heart surgery. But about 6 months ago, what is it exactly now? I say about 6 months.
Well, it was diagnosed on July 22nd.
All right, so it, by golly, it's coming up on 6 months here next week. He was diagnosed with a brain tumor, a cancerous tumor that was about the size of a cue ball. He had it removed and has been on an unbelievable transformation in a relationship with his Father God through this whole process. And I guess one of the things I'd like to ask you is, did you believe in prayer before your catastrophic illness?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And do you believe in it more now?
A lot more.
How did you how did you see prayer work for you?
If it's real true prayer and real true faith, it really it'll even affect you physically and help you calm you down, give you some reassurance. Not only mentally and psychologically, but also physically, and it'll help you rationalize things, I think, better.
Prayer will, and prayer and meditation, we should say.
That's right.
And by the way, it's interesting. Maybe you've known this all your life. I just figured this out in the last few months. I always thought meditation was something that people did with their legs crossed on a soft blanket with weird music in the background, and they were going, but I've realized that meditation is really listening.
Quieting down.
Yeah, which believe it or not, is not easy for me to do.
I can believe that.
Yeah. But it is. It's meditation.
Yeah.
And that's listening to what God has to say, where prayer is speaking out loud, speaking to God.
Yeah. If you quiet yourself down, and all of a sudden words or images or thoughts will come into your mind. And my thinking is, or my feeling is, that if I quiet myself down, suddenly I can, or gradually I can listen to God.
Yeah.
That really quiets you down.
And the challenging thing to understand is he's always been talking to you. You just haven't taken the time to listen.
Yeah, I was too busy with life.
Yeah.
Too busy with the happenings of life in medicine and family and whatever.
Gildy asks if you've ever heard of a Dr. Cantu, C-A-N-T-U, from Massachusetts General. He did his brain surgery.
No,
I just thought I'd bring that up. Why are you biting your tongue, Gildy? I'm an organ donor, and I would hope my heart would go to an unbeliever so they could experience God from the inside out. Oh, that's good. And then Gildy says, biting my tongue. What are you biting your tongue about, Gildy? All right, we'll catch up with you on that in a minute. By the way, if you want to jump onto the chat, please do so. And I don't know if you've noticed, but if you're watching this live, the chat is going on to your right. But if you're watching this pre-recorded, the chat that's going on is also live. So even though the program is pre-recorded, you're able to go in and chat live with other people who may be watching the program at the same time. All right. Let's talk for a minute, Dr. Ron, about science versus faith, because you're a scientist. Every doctor is really a scientist. To some degree, there's more than others. A general practitioner is probably less of a scientist than someone like yourself who did heart surgery. And then there are certainly people who are doctors or physicians who operate at a higher level in research and things like that, that operate more in the world of science. But you are a scientist. And that's how you kind of approached a lot of what you did in your medical practice. now all of a sudden you are confronted with a transformational event in your life. And explain to us how science fell short for you.
Well, I don't think it did.
Okay.
I think it's with us today. It's a gift from God, and it's part of our life, and we can't necessarily say it fell short. It's just a fact of life, and sometimes our own bodies or our own thoughts and that fall short, but the laws of science are there, and those were put there by God.
But there's a lot of people in your profession that would disagree with that.
True.
I'm assuming you've met a lot of people in your life who say that science has nothing to do with God, and it is man creating intelligence and research and information and different findings, and they're the ones, the scientists, the doctors, the surgeons, who create these life-saving measures and has nothing to do with God.
Yeah, and I understand their thinking, which is, to my thinking, limited.
Did you ever think like that?
Never really gave it too much thought.
Okay.
Yeah. Not until something dramatic happens to your life, sometimes you do anything. So that's an argument against me, of course. But if you don't think about it after something happens, then you haven't received the gift that you need to receive in order to quiet your soul.
How would your life have been different? Think for a moment and tell me about your life if at age 25 rather than 65, did you say?
68, yeah.
68, you had had this theological transformation. I'm not talking about the cancer or the tumor, but if somehow you had this theological and Christian transformation at 25 rather than 68, how would your life have been different?
I don't know that, but I can speculate. Probably I would have been a missionary.
Really?
Medical missionary.
Yeah.
I'd had that in my mind when I was in high school to some extent, and then I lost it, of course, when I got involved in science, of course, and then medicine eventually. And then you get married and you have kids and all that goes, you know, in a different direction.
By the wayside.
Yeah.
Do you think that... do you think God brings a disease like this into people's lives?
No, I don't think so. Okay. I think this just happens because we're imperfect.
Okay.
And we're imperfect because of our sin and that sort of thing. Science is not perfect. Well, the world is not perfect. And therefore, we have these kind of things happen.
Where do you think... Okay, now, let me back up. I don't want to put words in your mouth. I'm going to try to connect a couple of dots here, and maybe I'm going to do this incorrectly. Do you think that your cancer is a result of sin?
It's a result of imperfection in the world of sin.
All right, and does that imperfection come from man's free will? In other words, could you have done anything to not get that tumor?
We don't know, but this particular tumor is not associated with anything. So you know, with lung cancer, if you're smoking, you get lung cancer. And so I can't answer that.
I listened to a woman the other day who, and she sounded a little extreme when I first started listening to her, but as I listened more and more, she got my curiosity up. She feels that one of the primary causes for leukemia, cancer, this, we just seem to have it so much around us, is the preservatives in food. It is the toxins that we naturally put in our body through hairspray and deodorant. It is in our drinking water, not that it came naturally, but the stuff we put in our drinking water, the stuff that we consume into our body voluntarily. Any thought on that?
Yeah, and it's easy to fall into that trap, and all of these people tend to say, we feel that, or there isn't a lot of scientific evidence of this. There is scientific evidence of certain chemicals, but a lot of them have not been truly proven. I think it has a lot more to do with stress in our life.
Really?
And I think stress in our life does many, many things to our body, including our immune system and not just our cardiac system. I mean, you get stress in your life, you can get a rash. You know,
yeah.
It causes you have skin problems. It can cause you have gut problems and all that kind of thing.
Now, you're not talking about physical stress. You're talking about psychological stress.
Psychological stress.
You know, and it's interesting because we tie it right back then into prayer. Because prayer and meditation,
really
at least for me, and from what you've said, is the easiest way to eliminate or greatly reduce stress in our lives.
I agree with you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That and teenagers.
Definitely.
Yeah. Kids.
Yeah.
I don't mean that jokingly. If my children are watching, I love you dearly. But when I think about the stress in my life, where does the stress in my life come from? It comes from my love and caring for my family and not knowing how to do that the right way all the time and then messing up my relationships with my kids and my family because I pushed too hard or didn't push hard enough and, anyway, created stress. So you find out you have this tumor, and what does science tell you to do to treat it?
Well, we have the gift of a lot of things in science, medical science, and that is a gift of surgery. So that can be used, and it was. It took out the tumor the size of a cue ball. And then we have other gifts of radiation and gifts of chemotherapy. And these are gifts that, you know, God has allowed us to develop.
No. Developed those, didn't he?
Well, you didn't listen to me.
I know. I'm being sarcastic. Yeah, your belief is that God blessed man with the ability to come up with these things.
Yeah. Through free will. That's
sure.
Why we have free will.
Yeah.
To come up with these gifts.
And when we misuse free will,
then we're in trouble.
It becomes evil.
Yeah.
I started the show today with that cartoon from Michael Ramirez and about the young man who killed those people down in Tucson. And everybody, you know, we seem to have, for the last week, wanted to point fingers at everybody.
Yeah, blame everybody else. Yeah.
We forget this guy's got free will. You know, he had the free will to do what he did, and that's why it happened. Mm-hmm. Anyway, Dr. Ron Gruters is my guest today, and we're talking about the fact that 6 months ago he discovered that he had a cue ball size tumor on his brain, and it was removed, and he got chemotherapy and radiation. And are you cancer free at this point?
Well, at this point, there's no detectable cancer, but you know that's just 6 months out, so we have to continue to have examinations and probably MRIs to see what progresses, if anything.
Now, you discovered this because you started to have some cause and effect, memory loss, confusion, things like that.
Some confusion, yeah.
How long do you think, I guess this is a scientific question, how long do you think that tumor had been growing on your brain?
I have no idea. The neurosurgeon said it could have been there up to a year.
Okay. And are there ways that you could have discovered that before having some of the symptoms that you did?
As far as I know, there are no screening devices for brain tumors, like there are screening devices for other cancers.
Okay.
or heart disease. And the other thing is brain tumors, primary brain tumors, are not very common. You know, about 1% of all tumors
are brain tumors.
Primary brain tumors, yeah.
And a tumor, from a medical standpoint, a tumor is a growth that shouldn't be there? Is that?
It's a group of cells where they don't die as quickly as they're supposed to. They're supposed to be a recycling of normal cells recycle. They die off as they duplicate. Whereas a tumor, it keeps right on reduplicating, but there's less cell death. And that's going to be probably one of the ways we're going to be able to control it sometime is unlock those mysteries.
Yeah, what did I see the other day on the news? The big talk is a blood test. that now can help determine cancer?
Did you I don't know much more about it other than it picks up one cell out of, you know, 20 billion cells.
Yeah.
And then where it goes from there, how what we do with that information, who knows what's going to happen. I don't think they've answered that question yet.
Yeah. Do you think we'll ever have a cure for cancer?
Not in our lifetime.
No, but my grandkids?
Yeah, maybe.
Will my 13-year-old grandson die of cancer?
I don't know.
We don't know that yet.
Yeah.
I mean, when you look back at it, polio was a debilitating disease that killed people, and now we've basically eradicated that from our lives through research and passion. There's a lot of research and passion behind cancer.
Yeah, well, the polio is different. It's one disease. Cancer is much different. It's, you know, hundreds of different diseases.
Yeah.
So if when you say cancer, you got to say what kind of cancer.
And 100 years ago when someone died of cancer, and I'm specifically choosing 100, 125, 150 years ago when someone died of cancer, we just called it natural causes, didn't we?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, they just got sick and died. Yeah. Just amazing where we.
Of course, a lot of them didn't. A lot of us didn't live old enough to get cancers, man. Because you got to remember, at the turn of the century, 1900s, in America itself, the average life expectancy for a male was about 47 years old.
Wow!
And of course, now you know it's
twice
almost twice that.
Yeah. Yeah. That's amazing.
And so, cancer is also a disease of aging. So
it's the breaking down of the body's immune system.
Yeah, it's a breaking down of the DNA in those cells, and then of course the immune system also if it isn't sensitive enough when you're older, it doesn't detect it and doesn't destroy some of those cells to prevent it. But
all right, here's a question I would have: if it's a natural breakdown of the DNA in the cells in our body, then how do we know? How did you know? I'll make it personal for you. How did you know God wanted you to be healed? I mean, is at some point don't you say, well, God wants me to come home, and this is how He's going to end my physical life and bring my soul to heaven?
I can't answer that. I mean, I'd have to have you ask that question several times to really answer it. But you don't know that.
Yeah,
you know, that's the mystery of life. That's what makes life interesting. God-given gifts, your life, other lives, make it so interesting that if we try to pigeonhole things into stuff, we lose that mystery of life.
Yeah.
And you have to consider that. You don't want to lose the mystery of life.
Dr. Ron Gruters is my guest. We're going to take a break, and we'll be back. We'll continue this conversation tomorrow. Pastor John Anison from Lutheran Church of Hope City Branch. Great story. A couple years ago, he was led by God to start a brand new church, and a church that ministers to the homeless, a church that ministers to the inner city. It is not a church filled with middle-class white people in a suburb in Des Moines, Iowa. It is a church that serves the least of us. And after all, that's what the Bible tells us we should do. That's tomorrow, View from the Pew. We'll be back with Dr. Ron Gruters right after this, live on webcastonelive.com.
Get away from us, you mean old credit card. We don't have any more money.
We're in trouble now.
Save us!
Help! Somebody save us!
Somebody help!
Help!
Save us!
Hi, I'm Tom Coates from Consumer Credit of Des Moines. If your credit card's a little too animated, give us a call.
Hooray! We're saved! Super Credit! You're our hero!
The Kincaids live here. Across the street, the Padillas. Ben and his family live here, too. Ben's a RE/MAX agent, and he's a big part of this community. There are lots of reasons why RE/MAX agents average more sales than other agents. Experience, certainly. But maybe it's also because they care about the markets they serve and the neighbors who rely on them. Nobody sells more real estate than RE/MAX.
From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios. Listen. watch, chat. This is Webcast One Live.
Programs on WebcastOneLive.com are brought to you in part by KDC Builders, building custom homes for how you live. KDC will take your dreams and turn them into reality. Go to our website, KDCBuilt.com, or call Hannah Inman at 515-975-9990. And Tom Coates and ConsumerCreditOfAmerica.com. Are you overwhelmed with mounted credit card debt and feel there's no way out? Well, there is. Call 1-800-955-5765 for Consumer Credit of America. That's ccofamerica.com.
All right, we are back. 14 minutes before the top of the hour on this, the 13th day of January in the Lord's year 2011. I'm J. Michael McCoy. Michael Libby, Insight on Business, coming your way at high noon today. Always a great show. If you've never caught that show, make sure you tune in and find out what's going on with Michael. I don't know if you caught Liz's show earlier, but we have a brand new set. And what I mean by set is it's not a TV set like hangs on your wall. It is the set. It is the furniture. It is the background that we built for Liz and Ryan's show, and oh my gosh, it's just incredible. By the way, you're always welcome to come down here to the studios. I get down here about 9 o'clock every morning, a little bit before. You're always welcome to come on down and sit in on the studio and sit in on the show. And you never know, you could become an intricate part of Max World, like people like Gildy have, or TVIC, people who have taken the time to get involved with the platform, and we sure appreciate everybody's involvement with the platform, whether you're chatting, whether you're simply listening, whether you're participating. I know this is kind of hokey, but this is kind of your internet platform. I mean, that's what WebcastOneLive.com was designed around. It was designed around you. And you may be thinking about, man, I'd love to do my own show. Well, you can. And it's very simple. All you need is passion and a little bit of time. And everything else we supply for you. In fact, if you go to MaxWorldLive.com, that's MacsWorldLive.com, right in the middle under previous shows, you'll see kind of a description that I've laid out on all the different things that we offer and the investment on your part and what you need to do to get your own show started right here on WebcastOneLive.com. So we're glad to have you here. All right. My special guest today is Dr. Ron Gruters, who is a heart surgeon from Iowa Methodist for his entire career here in Des Moines. And about 6 months ago, was diagnosed with a brain tumor, had surgery, had it removed, has been receiving chemotherapy and radiation. But that's not the transformation that really happened in his life. The transformation that really happened in his life was his walk with his Father God. He had a strong one before, but now, well, it's consumed his life in a good way. And it has showed him the things that are important to him and the things that should be important to other people in their life. And he's spending his time sharing those things with us. Now, we talked a little bit about science versus faith. And you've brought up an example of the Big Bang and the mathematics in chemistry and DNA. Boy, that's way above my pay grade. So kind of explain to me what it is you're thinking about here and how that fits together.
One of the things that scientists are contemplating now is that we have a certain amount of time since the Big Bang, 14 billion years, say. But then you go to the chemicals in our body, and they say everything happened randomly, and we were put together, this world was put together randomly. But if you really look at it, it would probably run out of time if we consider that. And let's give you an example. Let's just take in our body, there's insulin. Well, insulin is a huge molecule with lots of atoms, molecular weight of over 150,000. And if you take that, if you consider that that happened randomly, you take each atom and throw them in a pond, shake them up, throw one out. No, that's not insulin. No, that's not insulin. No, that's not. And do it about every second. You run out of time in this world. You run out of 14 billion years.
Yeah.
And that's just insulin, which is a small molecule compared to our DNA and many other chemicals in the world, in life,
yeah,
so to speak. And that alone, yeah, that's probably not, I mean, that's speculation again, but it's logical speculation, and as far as I'm concerned, and you just cannot put your faith in that. Then you go, what then? Well, then you turn to creation.
Right.
And you put, and then you go, well, who is before God? Nobody. Because God's timeless. So there wasn't any measure of time there. God's not controlled by dimensions. It's spiritual. And then you kind of reflect on that. And you really come to the conclusion that, you know, we're here not because of chance, but because some intelligence put us here. Or put the world here, and that's how I feel about it. That's why. That's how I've come to the conclusion. We have a God. I mean, there's just too many great things that had to happen by chance. And you know, just take the Earth and the Moon. If you didn't have that relationship, you wouldn't have tides. If you didn't have that relationship, you wouldn't have, you know, different kinds of fishes and shellfish and all that kind of stuff. Well, and that's just one accident, if it was an accident. No, it wasn't an accident.
Yeah, it's interesting when people and I love conversations about creation.
Yeah.
I mean, I really do. They're some of my favorite. And when people, you know, start with the proclamation that there is no God, it just amazes me. I'm like a puppy that just stands up and wants to play because I find that so interesting. That people would think that this comes from
nowhere.
Nowhere. That's right.
Yeah.
That everything is happenstance. It's a coincidence. In fact, you know my favorite Machism. Machism number 3. Coincidence is God's way of revealing himself. Every time somebody says to me, oh, what a coincidence. I ran into you or I saw you or blah, I go, no, not really. God kind of intended for that to happen. Do you think that, and this just, I know this is just an opinion that I'm asking.
Sure.
But you're a scientist, and you know, you've seen the progression that science has taken in your lifetime, greater than any other time in man's history. But we're now to the point where we talked earlier in the last segment about saving lives through medicine. Well, we're now to the point where we're creating lives through medicine. We are, you know, you and I grew up with... Lee Majors in the $10 million man or the $1 million man, whatever he is. Well, that's become a reality. We can change out $6 million. Thank you, Amir. We can change out almost any body part. We can change out hearts. We can limbs, almost any body function. We haven't had a brain replacement yet.
I'll be hoping for one of those.
Well, me too. Give me a smart one next time. But... as a Christian scientist, not as a Christian science, but as a Christian scientist, how do you think medicine can go too far? Do you think cloning is going too far? I mean, you know, it's God's gift. You've got people who live right down the road here, the Amish. We read all the time about people who refuse any type of medical attention for their children or for themselves in knowing that God will heal these people. So it is not too far down the road. It is not too far down the road history-wise where people would tell you that some of the things we're doing today is ungodly or ungodlike when it comes to science and medicine.
Or too godlike.
Or too godlike.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
How do you think about that?
Well, I think you have to take each component separately. I mean, I think that's where God allows our free will to think about that. There are some things that will be nice and be good and help people with their pain and all that if we can, you know, construct them, if we can create them, create them with God's help. There are other things that will be destructive. To our society or to our person, if we allow some of those things to happen, and that'll be the debate the next 100 years or more if we're still here, or if mankind is still here.
Yeah, if we haven't destroyed ourselves by then.
And I mean, he allowed us to create nuclear energy. or not create it, but at least can, you know, develop it.
Yeah.
And nuclear fission and nuclear fusion, and these are gifts if we use them right. These are, you know, curses if we use them wrong.
Yeah. Now,
and we got to think about that before you go half cocked into something.
Tell me if this is a correct scientific statement. We would not have the treatment of radiation that has helped to save your life if it had not been for the nuclear bomb.
Well, at least if it hadn't been for several individuals that figured out what radiation was. The nuclear bomb, I don't know.
We don't know which came first, the nuclear bomb or...
Well, I mean, no, radiation detection, X-ray therapy, or X-rays and therapy came before nuclear weapons in the Manhattan Project. But I don't think you could state that entirely.
I wasn't sure about that.
Yeah.
And mathematics is a lot, is involved a lot in science. And you wouldn't think that. We think mathematics is only involved in engineering, or it's only involved in accounting. How is mathematics involved in science?
Well, the physiology of organs, the physiology of life forms can be put into mathematics. Now, I'm not a mathematician, so I can't exactly tell you how, but all of these are formulas that can be constructed into mathematics. And that's why it's so hard for some people to say, well, then we have to have the world developed by chance, because we can calculate chance.
Yeah.
You know, we can calculate. And that gives us some power over the creation, so to speak, power over the world, power over chemicals and all those sort of things. Mental power, by the way. But it doesn't work that way.
No,
it works
doesn't.
More with things we can't see are forever. Things we see are come and go. And that's one of the things that scientists have not been able to handle either.
Yeah. Yeah, I always enjoy when someone who is not faith-based and they think that science is the answer for everything, how they justify some of the new scientific discoveries. My biggest kick was when they decided Pluto was no longer a planet. You and I grew up in school.
Yeah.
It's almost like I can see my books now with the planets, and there they are, and Pluto was a planet. And then in 2008 or 9, excuse me, we decided it wasn't a planet.
Yeah, it's a planetoid.
Yeah, how do we come
whatever
up with
that? Whatever, that's too small.
Yeah, well, but, yeah, it's a moon. I sure appreciate you spending some time with me again. I hope you enjoy this.
Yeah, that's fun.
Yeah, I'm going to have you back again.
I mean, you can't get total answers, but... Why, if we had all the total answers, it wouldn't be any more fun in life.
That's right.
You know.
That's right. And the answers are there.
Our faith makes it fun.
Yeah. I've always said the answers are there. God just hasn't revealed to us, or we haven't worked hard enough to find God's will to find those answers.
Yeah.
You know, it seems like in my life, at least, I can't speak for anybody else, but when I make the great discoveries for my life, it's because I have grown closer to God. And when I find the biggest disasters and the biggest traumas and the biggest disappointments in my life, I seem to have strayed farther from God. So I guess the closer we get to Him, the more answers we've got.
We just experienced that in our family with the loss of a little one, 11-month-old suddenly.
Yeah, that's right. I apologize. And, I forgot about that.
And I'll tell you, without faith, that family... And they had a lot of faith. That family would fall apart, you know, or families do fall apart, by the way. They were so strong, they kind of held up others. We all could see it. And about that same time, I have to tell you some other time, we got a book called Heaven is for Real. And if few people can get a hold of it, definitely read it.
Heaven is for real.
And I'm not going to tell you what it's about, but it came, my wife was reading it 24 hours before we heard about our little one, my brother's grandchild that, you know, had died. And it was almost like, oh, God put that book there for us to read prior to this. And that book is just really helps one.
And tell me what it's called again.
Heaven is for Real.
Heaven is for Real, okay.
And the author is Todd Burpo, B-U-R-P-O.
Okay. Well, I'll look forward to hearing more about that book. And, yeah, my blessings and prayers with your
family.
Oh,
you got to read it. You got to read it.
Really?
Yeah.
Got to read it.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I'll read it.
It 2 or 3 hours and you're done, but you can't put it down.
Okay, Heaven is for Real. All right, Dr. Ron Gruters has been my guest today. We'll see him back in 4 to 6 weeks as we learn more and more about his progression and his recovery and his transformation of faith. Until then, we thank you for taking the time to listen to this podcast or watch this program. My name is J. Michael McCoy, and if I didn't have this program, well, it brings a lot of joy to my life. And I thank you for taking the time to make me a part of your life right here at MaxWorldLive.com.
From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios,
listen, watch, chat.
This is Webcast One Live. Programs on WebcastOneLive.com are brought to you in part by KDC Builders, building custom homes for how you live. KDC will take your dreams and turn them into reality. Go to our website, KDCBuilt.com, or call Hannah Inman at 515-975-9990. And Tom Coates and ConsumerCreditOfAmerica.com. Are you overwhelmed with mounted credit card debt and feel there's no way out? Well, there is. Call 1-800-955-5765 for Consumer Credit of America. That's ccofamerica.com.